Hello, I'm Mark. In part one of the series, we looked at the basic shapes of imaging systems. We're now going to look at some auxiliary shapes that get used with the basic shapes to extend their usefulness. We'll look at field flatteners, which reduce the field curvature of a design. Then we'll look at fisheye lenses, which allow other lenses to work over very wide fields of view. We'll look at eyepieces, which are used when the human eye is the final detecting stage. And we'll finish off with telephoto lenses, which are important whenever we need to reduce the size of a basic shape. As ever, please like and subscribe if you want to see more of this kind of video, and let me know in the comments what kinds of topics you'd like to see covered. And now, let's get on with the auxiliary optics used with the basic shape lens systems. Let's look back at the Petzval lens from the first part of this series. Its dominant aberration is field curvature, and its spot performance is diffraction limited across approximately two-thirds of its field of view. If we optimize the radius of the image surface itself, the spot size becomes diffraction limited over its entire field of view, and we could probably increase the field of view of the Petzval as a consequence. Why does this happen? Well, an imaging system will always want to form its image on a curved surface known as the Petzval radius. This is true even if the lens is not of the Petzval type, and Petzval is known for the lens design that bears his name, as well as this radius, amongst many other things. This is why your eyeball is spherical. By forming the retina on a curved surface, the field curvature of the eye's lens is compensated. The radius of the Petzval surface is equal to the effective focal length of the lens. In this case, the lens effective focal length is 50 millimeters, and the radius we optimize the image surface to is 55 millimeters. Why did it not optimize to exactly 50? Because field curvature is not the only field-dependent aberration. 55 millimeters turns out to be optimum to reduce the size of the spot when averaged over all fields and wavelengths. Now, it's not practical to make curved solid-state detectors, so it's better to add a negative-powered lens very close to the image plane. This lens is called a field flattener and has the same effect as a curved image plane. If you imagine inserting a flat window in this location, you'll see that the image plane is pushed back by a constant amount at all fields. If you let the thickness vary, you can control the amount of image pushback, so it is pushed back most at the edge of the field and least at the centre, thus compensating field curvature. Here's another way to see how field flatteners work. We take the field flattener from the previous example and illuminate it with a thin pencil of rays that is scanned over the field of view. On axis, the EFL of this lens is minus 47.42mm, and at the edge of the field of view, this is changed to minus 46.14. Remember, the power of the two surfaces is unchanged. What is changing is the contribution from the lens thickness. The ray bundle at the edge of the field passes through a thicker amount of glass with the same curvature as the central ray bundle sees, with the net effect that the focal length is reduced slightly at the edge of the field of view, pushing the image location further back, and this compensates the field curvature. Also note that at the edge of the field, a field flattener looks somewhat like a prism, and so field flatteners contribute lateral colour. The field flattener itself does not compensate astigmatism, but since it is handling field curvature duties, the other variables are freed up to balance the other aberrations. As a result, field flatteners can improve the resolution of all the other basic shapes, assuming field curvature is a limiting aberration. Field flatteners can also be made of two glasses, made aspheric, and so on, but the general operational principle remains the same. This auxiliary basic shape adds a field-dependent focal shift to balance field curvature of the sensor referenced system. Let's now look at lenses with very wide fields of view, and specifically at the basic shape called the fisheye lens. Here is a lens with a plus or minus 100 degree, or in other words, 200 degree full field of view, working at f2.15 over the visible. Let's look first at the later parts of the system. Looking from surface 8 onwards, we see a normal double Gauss derivative. This lens has a field of view of about plus or minus 20 degrees, and we've met this type of lens design before in the basic shape sequence. Looking from surface 1 to surface 10, and so keeping element 4 in shot, you can see that this lens group called a fisheye lens converts the plus or minus 100 degree field of view into about plus or minus 20 degrees. Light at 100 degrees is incident on the first lens at 89 degrees grazing incidence. It then enters the second lens at 68 degrees, the third one at 48 degrees, and finally enters the primary imaging system at 22 degrees. The fisheye basic shape is a three elements group of negative power. It has a very strong negatively powered front lens that captures lights over the desired field of view, and the other two lenses reduce the angular range of the captured light so that the field of view as seen by the first lens of the imaging group is within a normal range. We refer to the chain of lenses from surface 8 onwards as the primary imaging lens, and the entire lens system is often called a wide-angle lens. So how does a fisheye lens work? Well, let's look at the location of the pupil in the lens in a fisheye lens using a graphic created by Pierre Toscani in an article I linked to in the description of this video. You can see that the location, size, and orientation of the real entrance pupil changes as a function of field. Now, this happens in any optical system with field, but in the fisheye, it is a gross effect, and it's the fundamental reason why a fisheye lens works. The entrance pupil is not static, but moves forward and rotates towards the distant field point. This motion is clear if you ever look into a fisheye lens and tilt it. One consequence of the fisheye's reduction of the angular range is that distortion cannot be removed. The distortion is so large that it often is not even quoted. You basically get what you're given. There is an inherent distortion called the mapmaker's problem in trying to represent structure on a spherical surface on a flat surface. And we can see that distortion dominates the Zeidel plot. Ignoring that shows that field curvature is the limiting aberration, as we might expect. Note the multi-order field curvature correction. Eyepieces are used in conjunction with any optical system that has scope in its name. Telescope, microscope, endoscope, rifle scope, and so on. It is used to convert the output of these systems to an image that can be seen by the human eye. The requirement to accommodate the human eye makes this a very different basic shape to the ones we have looked at so far in some important ways. It is almost always designed the wrong way around so that the eye is treated as the source of rays. The aperture stop of an eyepiece represents the location of the pupil of the eye, typically 5 mm diameter unless night use is expected, and we require a long distance between that surface and the first glass surface of the eyepiece, called the eye relief. Eye relief should be a minimum of 10 millimetres to allow eyelashes, 15 millimetres for greater comfort than that, 20 millimetres to allow for use of spectacles, and greater than 90 millimetres when used with rifle sights to allow for recoil. This is a significant design parameter. Eyepieces usually also allow a focal adjustment of about 4 diopters to accommodate different users, so a movement along Z to adjust focal length must be provided. This is usually the intra-lens separation. This plot shows the variation of effective focal length with the lens separation. One additional benefit of designing these lenses the wrong way round is that the eye's pupil is used as the direct value of the system stop, and so no ray aiming is needed to account for pupil aberrations, and no ray tracing is needed at all to establish the entrance pupil diameter. We simply state its size by the semi-diameter of the stop surface. The eye can resolve about 1 minute of arc, a 60th of a degree on axis, about 3 minutes of arc at 5 degrees, and about 10 minutes of arc at 20 degrees in bright illumination, and drops as illumination decreases. The eyepiece is therefore usually designed to be somewhat better than this to not limit the viewer's perception, but is not necessarily designed for ultimate imaging performance. Eyepieces are usually designed for best performance on axis, as this is usually where the object of interest is placed. Distortion going off axis is usually allowable as imaging remains sharp. As seen in this example, rays from the edge of the field traverse the periphery of the lens and so generate large amounts of astigmatism, lateral colour, coma, and distortion. There is almost always pressure on the lens designer to make the optical system as short as possible. The effective focal length is a guide to how long a lens will be. In the absence of a specific constraint, most lens designs will migrate to a solution where the ratio of physical length to effective focal length is something like 1 to 1.3 or greater. This ratio is called the telephoto ratio and is a good guide to how hard the design will have to work in order to achieve a given level of performance. The smaller the required telephoto ratio, the harder the design will be for a given F number, field of view, and wavelength range. In this design, we have an F10, entrance pupil diameter 10, and hence effective focal length 100 millimeters, 5-degree field of view design working across the visible. But we have an additional constraint that the overall length be 75 millimeters, giving a telephoto ratio of 0.75. This design form leads to a powerful front doublet element, followed by a powerful negative element that matches the system F number to the required value and provides field aberration control. As the telephoto ratio decreases, the designer will move from singlets to doublets, to the Cook triplet, to Cook variants such as the Tessar and Heliar, the double Gauss and its variants, and so on. A telephoto ratio below about 0.6 will generally be very demanding, with lots of elements, including those with aspheric surfaces, needed to provide aberration balancing. Whatever form the final design takes, a telephoto lens, which has a ratio less than 1, will be formed by a positive lens group of shorter EFL than required, followed by a negative group that matches the system to the required effective focal length. Lenses with a focal length F want to form images on a sphere with radius of approximately F. A negative lens placed close to the image pushes the focal plane back by an amount that depends on where the rays are in the aperture of the lens. This provides a field-dependent offset. The variation of this lens's focal length with system field compensates field curvature. Wide-angle lenses cover greater than 180-degree fields of view and consist of a fisheye group and a primary imaging group. The three-element fisheye converts wide angles to moderate angles and introduces large amounts of map-maker distortion. The fisheye's entrance pupil shifts and rotates to allow wide-angle lights into the system. A double Gauss or other basic shape provides the primary imaging group. Eyepieces adapt an optical system to the human eye as the final detector. They are usually designed the opposite way round to how they are used. An intra-lens Z adjustment provides about 4 diopters of power change to accommodate different users. Human eye acuity defines the performance criteria. Making a lens shorter than its effective focal length makes the design more difficult. Telephoto ratios of less than about 0.6 are very difficult. They need more highly corrected basic shapes as a result. Tessars instead of Cooks, double Gausses instead of Tessars, etc. This leads to an overall two-group approach with lots of positive power being corrected by a negative power. These auxiliary lenses are used in conjunction with the basic shapes of imaging systems to provide application-specific additional performance. Learning to see the design of an imaging system in terms of its underlying basic shape and any auxiliary optics is really helpful in understanding how a system works, what limits its performance, and how to develop it further.